I've got a special guest with me. We'll talk probably half an hour. Dr. Jeff Matheson came in from Toronto, very kind of him, pain management expert. So we can talk a lot about any kind of pain management, from headaches, chronic pain, anything. The way I got into this field, I'm an engineer by training. So how'd you get into it? My wife became diabetic, doing everything. She was told by the doctors, by the nutritionists, eating the way she was told, exercising the way she was told. She was thin. Comes type 1 diabetic at age, 35. So it's, how the heck did this happen? So I went to the health store and started looking, because they knew I was a good science guy. And I did what you do. I'd read one book by one guy, like Atkins, saying no carbs. I'd read another book by somebody else, like Ornish, saying all you want is carbs and no fat, no protein. So it's who I believe. And I'll tell you this, always do. Don't believe anybody. Don't even want you believing me. Follow and believe the science. So the question is there a field of science? Yeah, there's two: physiology, how the tissues work, how the cells work, and biochemistry. Where are the metabolic pathways? How do they go? And luckily, I live in Houston, Texas. We have the top cancer center in the world, MD Anderson. They were kind enough to let me use their medical library, the Jesse Jones Library, on the campus there for years. And they have 320,000 volumes of medical books, medical journals, 320,000 categories, one of the top 10 in America. Going back to the early 1800s. So anybody telling you we didn't know this in 1900, it wasn't tracked, is absolutely wrong. They exactly knew what cancer looked like in 1900. It's pretty easy. So after years of going through this stuff, it was like, the science is on the left, what everybody's told is on the right. Somebody's got to start writing about this scientifically. And there were a couple decent books out there. There was Protein Power, he was probably the best, that had science, but nobody really did it well enough. So I started on the path, and the biggest thing, because diabetes is such a chronic problem, is sugar's here, carbohydrates here, they are the same thing. Carbohydrates are sugar in disguise. The only thing that doesn't count is fiber, because fiber is sawdust, and sawdust is not food for a human being. So unless you're a human billy goat in disguise, you can't digest it. That's for termites. It's wood. So when people are telling you you need fiber, we'll talk about that after if you want, why on earth would a human being need to be eating sawdust? Doesn't get metabolized, actually irritates, and the women eating the most fiber got the most colon cancer. This was published in 1999 and 2000 in the America's top medical journals, and now it's reversed. You're back to needing fiber. So carbohydrates here, sugar here. One number you need to memorize, 20. Every 20 calories of carbohydrate, every 5 grams of carbohydrate is a teaspoon of sugar. See, the medical journals, they don't taught this. They taught millimoles per deciliter, and that's wonderful. You go to your diabetic physician, 5 millimoles per deciliter is a very good number. That's 70 to 90 milligrams per deciliter. I'm an engineer. I like concrete, simple things. So teaspoons, how many teaspoons is there? So the first question is, how many teaspoons of sugar is in the blood? And I calculated it out, and it was less than a teaspoon. So it's, this can't be. I must have been off by a factor of 100. It had to be 100. I missed a decimal someplace. I do it again. Less than a teaspoon. Give it to a colleague. What did I do wrong? I did something wrong. I'm an idiot. He goes, no, you did nothing wrong. I said, less than a teaspoon. We're told a 2,000 calorie a day diet, 60% carbohydrates, right? Because that's what they tell you to live on. 60% of 1,200 is, or of 2,000 is 1,200. 1,200 divided by 20 is what? 60. So they're telling us to eat 60 teaspoons of sugar a day, unknowingly, and you have a system with one. So that was the first thing. Next thing is, where the heck do all the extra go? Well, they only go to one place. Well, they go two. They go to one, but they can use two places. I can either burn them up by doing exercise. So this is where the whole exercise program came from, with the high-carb diet. Because before the high-carb diet, didn't need exercise, wasn't even talked about. And women in 1920, 1930, 1940, 1950 were told don't do too much exercise. And they looked great. Go back to those movies. Same thing for the guys. There were no gyms. There were no anything. Everybody looked good. Unless they were told to be on a 60% carbohydrate diet, then they couldn't be good. So to get that excess sugar out of your system so you don't die, your body produces insulin. Insulin is defined in any medical textbook of physiology, fat storage hormone. So fat storage hormone, interesting. So if I don't eat the carbohydrates, maybe I don't get fat. Next question is, does fat and protein have the same fat storage capability? The answer is no. Fat does not go to fat. That's the next thing I learned. Does not go to fat. Saturated fat can't combine with anything. That's why it's saturated. So anybody telling you saturated fat causes a heart attack needs to go back to school and learn some science. It can't. We were told this for years. Incredible. However, with fats, there's a big thing. You have 100 trillion cells. Every cell is what's called a bilipid membrane. So just picture two circles next to each other, and they're fat. 50% fat, 50% protein. There's no carbohydrate in there. Out of those fats, 25 to 33% are called essential fats. Parent omega-6, parent omega-3, we can't make them. The animals can, but we can't. So we have to get those from food. And it turns out there's a major, major, major problem with the parent omega-6. It's all adulterated for food processing because that's the one they use to fry in. So all the margarine, all the processed oils, all the cooking oil in your supermarket is omega-6 based. You don't fry in omega-3 anything. It's too reactive, it goes bad. So you'll never see frying in flax oil, for example. Never happens. Never see frying in fish oil. Doesn't happen. You fry in a parent omega-6 oil. Parents and derivatives. The parent means it's the primary one, and then your body makes them actually longer for the derivatives. Not shorter, but longer. So they start out 18 chain carbons is the way they are, and they get bigger, and they do everything. Your average tissue, your heart, your liver, 4 to 1 in favor of parent omega-6. Your muscles are about 6.5 to 1. Your brain on the parent omega-6 to omega-3 parent is 100 to 1. Body fat is much more parent omega-6. So it turns out, physiologically, 11 to 1 parent omega-6 to omega-3. So anybody telling you we're overdosed on an omega-6 diet, number one, we're not overdosed. You need 11 to 1. Number two, we are overdosed on adulterated parent omega-6. The reason they adulterate it is to make it usable for frying so it doesn't go bad. So the fast food places can use the same oil for a month. Doesn't lose its oxygen. Problem is, we want it losing its oxygen in the body. It's called oxidation. That's how we get energy. So if the membrane can't transfer the oxygen, it's worthless. It's like a piece of plastic. Now imagine you have 100 trillion cells and a piece of non-functional plastic circling every cell. The insulin can't get through. That's one of the main reasons we have diabetes. Nothing can get through. You need more and more of it. And the oxygen can't get through. And the oxygen problem is the direct cause of cancer. This is Otto Warburg. And the reason you get a heart attack. You're starved from oxygen. So there's two ways in the cell you get the oxygen. Oxygen can go in from the blood. It disassociates and go through the membrane unless you have a piece of plastic where it can't get through. It's like something trying to get through a straw. It's not going to go. Or the cell membrane itself, it can disassociate, come apart, and the oxygen can go out of it and it gets replaced later. Nature never thought we would be so stupid as to adulterate these oils. It's also the reason for Alzheimer's, by the way. It's clogged capillaries. They don't know this. They don't look at it. You have probably 100 million capillaries in the brain. The lining and the material they're all made from is the parent omega-6. These make your hormones. It's called prostaglandins. PGE1 is the biggest anti-inflammatory in your body. So if you have arthritis, if you have aches and pains, anything with inflammation, you need the parent omega-6 so it can make that PGE1. The other thing it does is something called prostacyclin. It makes it where the blood platelets can't stick to that artery wall and can't stick to each other. So there's no adhesion to the wall, there's no adherence between them, and it's a vasodilator, so it makes it bigger, so there's blood flow. With Alzheimer's, with any kind of mental issue, you're not getting the blood flow. Also with headaches, it's lack of blood flow. That's why you're getting the pain. So this is Mother Nature's ideal substance. And again, you would get this in food. Seeds have it, nuts have it, even fruits have it, if you eat enough of them, the parent essential oils. But they're all adulterated. You need some of the parent omega-3, but that's not the prime issue. A lot of people say, what about Joanna Budwig? She was big in anti-cancer with adding the omega-3 from flax. In her day, that was more important. Today, it's all in the adulteration of the omega-6. You're not going to get functional omega-6 oil in the supermarket, in any of them, unless you get organic. So that's the biggest problem in the world. By the way, all your skin is made, it's directly parent omega-6. So if you touch my skin, I beat 20-year-old girls because I've got a secret. I'm loaded with this stuff. It's everywhere. Fingernails, no Hill Valley orange peel. Cellulite, it's not special fat. It's lack of these oils. It's like two pieces of paper together. They're not magnetized. There's no charge. They don't crumble, but if you have two magnets, they do. So there's ways you can tell if you have this deficiency. They're oxygenators, so you should have energy, boom. So these oils were incredible. Plus, they fulfill your appetite and cut the carbohydrate craving. They don't block it. They naturally cut it, because nature can't do anything except make you hungry and hope like the Dickens you're going to get the right food. So it's eat, crave, eat, crave, eat, crave. This is the human billy goat syndrome. Nature is going, will you please eat some of these oils? And we don't. The nuts have them, but most people aren't eating organic nuts. The seeds have them. Most people don't eat the seeds at all. The fruits have it, but we're not eating enough of the fruits. You don't want to, you know, you can eat them, but we just typically don't. So that's the number one problem in America. That is the number one health issue in America, is not getting the proper parent omega oils. Fish oil is all derivatives, DHA, EPA. They start from parent omega-3. They get converted, and they get this. How many people are taking fish oil? Probably a few of you. Very good. You do not want fish oil. It is a poison. There is a lot of it in the brain, in the white matter. Yeah, we switch them up. There's white matter and gray matter. They're 50-50. One of them has about 14% DHA in the brain, but there's also 10% of the omega-6 series arachidonic acid. The other part of the brain, I think it's the white matter, there's more parent omega-6 than omega-3, and even with the derivatives. So they're giving you a big, big misleading story with how much DHA and fish oil you need in your brain. You only use 7 milligrams a day, which is next to nothing. The average fish oil recommendation is grams. So you're getting 20 to 500 times too much. So if there's anybody you know, you do not want to be taking fish oil. So the right parent oils are the best, and they have to be organic. They have to have more parent omega-6 than omega-3. You also want some evening primrose in there to give extra GLA, which makes that PGE1, the body's number one anti-inflammatory. Because if you're diabetic, that pathway's impaired. If you're drinking a lot of alcohol, that pathway's impaired. If you have some other problems, that pathway is impaired. So by having the evening primrose oil in the formulation, you give it a boost. And that works beautifully. Don't need a lot of it. It's very, very powerful. And your body will convert it just fine. The next thing I discovered was there's no minerals in the soil. There's about 8 minerals that you need a lot of. Minerals are coenzymes, and they make the vitamins work. So everybody's taking vitamins, and they're missing the minerals. Without the minerals, the vitamins can't do the job. And they're called coenzymes. They make reactions go up to 1,000,000 times faster. They're also highly tied to energy production in the mitochondria, which is critical for oxygen to make sure you don't get cancer and to have energy. The reason they're not in the soil is because they don't use natural fertilizers. There's no cow manure, horse manure. They're synthetic fertilizers. So the plant looks great, and we get very sick. The typical way humans get their minerals is animal-based. The plant picks up the mineral, goes into the plant, the animal eats the plant, and we eat the animal. If it's just tied to the plant, we can't get the mineral out of it. It's tied to the cellulose. So it's bound there, and we can't digest cellulose. Remember I told you we can't digest sawdust? So we have no mechanism for getting rid of the mineral. So you really need some animal protein for the minerals. Even hardcore vegetarians will say this. So you need minerals, don't need a lot of them, but there's about eight you need. And calcium is not one of them. I always bring newspaper articles, but I don't want to go through them today because Dr. Matheson's here and we have limited time. But for broken bones, calcium does nothing for it. How many of you saw that in the paper in the past 6 months? Came out twice, they were wrong. Big articles. I was one of the first people to say, if you take a calcium supplement, you're gonna accelerate cardiovascular disease and getting a heart attack. It's called calcification of the plaque. It's the last stage of heart disease. If you're taking a calcium supplement, it just goes right out into the bloodstream and you've put yourself on the nice path of a heart attack. Horrible. Another big one came out with prophylactic mastectomies, which means if a woman thinks she's gonna have breast cancer with a BRCA gene or anything, she gets both breasts taken off before there's a big problem. Doctors were telling you this, and they just reversed it saying, we're wrong, it doesn't do anything. How many saw that article reversed? Anybody see any apologies? See, how the medical field can tell everybody to do something when there's no strong science is absolutely appalling to me. And they do it. They do it all the time. They don't have any science. They did it with HRT too. Oh, the OBGYNs thought giving HRT to women made you better, increases heart attacks through the roof. That's all changed. They didn't do any real trials. The doctor hears what they want to hear. Oh, like statins. Oh, there's no side effects. My memory's fine. My energy's fine. No, you lose your memory and you have no energy on a statin. There's reasons for that. They're horrible. Now there's black box warnings, which is the worst warning on a drug you can get. But for a decade and a half, physicians were saying, oh, there's no problem. All the people I talked to said I couldn't take the thing. I stopped it. So they hear what they want to hear. It's a real tragic situation today. So you need the organic, unadulterated oils. You need the minerals. What's the last thing you need? Well, we're getting a lot of junk we don't want, so you need a detoxifier. Well, what's that? You've all heard how bad meat is, right? The meat's not bad at all. It's what they put in the meat, and they're typically steroid-based growth hormones. This is the reason women are overdosed on estrogen. They're all estrogenic, so that's one of the big reasons. It's not because estrogen is going to harm you. You're making it, for crying out loud. This is how bad it is. Anybody thinking estrogen's going to harm a woman when Mother Nature designed it to be produced is crazy. If it's doing it, you got something way out of balance, and that's the food. The good part with that is if you cook a piece of meat a lot, you denature that estrogen component, so it inactivates it. I'm a big advocate of natural or organic, but that can get pretty pricey. The next best way is cook it a lot. And if there's any fat-based food you get, like eggs, cream, butter, cheese, make sure that's organic. That's where your money should go, because in the animal, all those residues go there. And also when you're dieting, you're burning your own body fat, those residues come out. That's a big reason you need a detoxifier to minimize this stuff. It's a blood purifier. So what I found was something called ESSIAC, E-S-S-I-I-C, there's a big history of it. I suggested adding cat's claw to it. That's an upper respiratory maximizer. And this is the best blood purifier in the world, meaning if stuff is in your bloodstream that shouldn't be there, this goes a long way to killing it. Father was in the hospital because relatives don't really listen to you taking anything, so of course they didn't pay any attention to my recommendations. Get a call from my mother. Your father's really bad shape. He had pneumonia, fell and broke, didn't break a hip, fractured something in his leg, and he's got a stage one urethral cancer tumor that the guy had to take out. And took it out, went home, came back in, and it acted up again with a problem. So he's saying he didn't get it all or something. So she goes, he's pretty bad. And I said, well, let me know how he is in a couple of days. So I call her back in 3-4 days. It's getting worse. I said, I'll be up there. He lives in Massachusetts. I live in Houston. Well, you don't need to come. I said, I sure as hell do need to come. This isn't good. He's 85. So I get there. Looks like death warmed over. Every time he urinates, he's screaming. A lot of pain. And blood in the urine. And my mother goes, I asked the doctor, is he going to make it or is he going to die? And he had sepsis, too. That's a systemic infection. So told the doctor, said, give me 3 days. Said, here's what I do. I'm a specialist in lipid pharmacognosy from these seed oils. Said, you're not going to know anything about it because nobody does. But give me 3 days. I'll turn your patient around. He goes, okay. Made him take a cup and a half of the liquid herbal, the detoxifier, because that coats the whole digestive system and the whole excretory system. Makes it very, very soothing. Gave him a ton of the PEO parent essential oil formulation, about 4 times the normal dose. You know, it's, I don't want to take all this. I said, I really don't care what you want to do. I said, you're not dying in front of me. You're taking it. So I was at the hospital 3 times a day. And day 3, pain is gone. Now your whole urethral tract is skin. Remember the parent omega 6? The inside lining on every artery is this parent omega 6 directly. Body doesn't change it at all. So every inside artery, every inside capillary in your brain is this stuff. Now what happens when you're getting it all adulterated? I'm amazed we're alive. I'm amazed we are alive. Turned around, 3 more days, he's out, and mother said, the guy's like, no. And doctor said, you make sure he keeps taking this. Now, they never give it to other patients because it's not a drug, but my mother was just beside herself. She goes, I had no idea. I said, well, I don't know why you didn't. I'm always sending you testimonials from around the world for years. I've written these books. Familiarity breeds contempt. So if nobody listens to you, your kids don't listen to you, your relatives don't listen. Don't worry, even physicians' relatives don't listen to them. That's why they got to get another one. It's a psychological law. So you put the three together, 2 parts bringing in the right stuff, the unadulterated oils, the minerals, 1 part minimizing the junk you don't want, which is the herbal optimizer. I don't know what else the average person needs. Those are the only three, and there's 3 reasons. Food adulteration, chemical fertilizers, again, going against nature. And then actually the 3rd one, the detoxifier, because junk we don't want either. That's man-made stuff too. That's the estrogenic compound. So we're doing it to ourselves. We are killing ourselves. If we didn't have processed food, I wouldn't be here. You wouldn't need me about this. That's the whole thing. But nobody seems to be getting it right with how critical these oils are. 100 trillion cells directly incorporated. And most people are getting 50 to 60% screwed up. Even the fine restaurants, they're not using organic oils. They're using the same junk oils everybody else does because that's the standard deal. Canola oil, you know, any of the stuff, it's all ruined. They used to use lard. They used to use coconut oil. Well, not anymore. You know, the right stuff that nature provided is all changed. Couple things are protein. People always ask me, too much protein, bad for the kidneys, bad for this, bad for this. I want to lose weight. Protein is a high amount of water, even a steak, big steak, 58% water after I cook it. I was appalled when I saw this. That's after I cook it. Piece of lettuce is 90% water. Piece of fish is about 80% after you cook it. So, geez, 60% of the 1 pound steak is gone right off the bat. Next big one, your body is very interesting. It uses that protein to fuel its own digestion. So to break down that steak, and it takes a heck of a lot of energy to break it down, Your body uses 60% of its caloric worth. And nobody eats calories, by the way. The calorie theory, I'll talk about that in a second. 60% of that amount is vaporized into burning it up. So the 16 ounces you ate as a steak is down to about 2.5 net ounces by the time you're done with it, by the time the water's gone and the energy to burn it up. So anybody telling you protein can make you fat, again, needs to get back into a medical textbook and learn something. It doesn't happen. So a higher protein diet is phenomenal to lose weight. One problem with it is it doesn't fill you up. And the proof of that is you can take 10 egg whites, cook them up, eat them, and 15 minutes later, I'm not full, my stomach's squashed, but only fats fill you up. So nature's trying to tell us you want some of those fats, and what happened? Fat's bad. Heard that by the medical community in America for 30 years, that ought to be shot. And there's never an apology, and all it is a reversal. Everything always gets reversed. New research shows, who did the old research and why aren't they in jail? Okay, calorie theory. 1893, Professor Fick, MD, PhD, proved humans are not heat engines, we're chemical factories. Calorie theory is based on throwing wood into a fireplace. It burns up and you got a certain amount of heat. We're not that same way. We don't have a heat gradient. We're the same temperature, 98.6, right, all across of us. The other thing is, does anybody here actually think a fat, protein, and carbohydrate are all the same? And you just burn them? That's the other thing the calorie theory is. I just told you, the oils, they're all essential. They go to the cell makeup. It's not burned. The protein, it makes your muscles, it makes your hormones, makes your enzymes. That's not burned. So anybody telling you it's calories is an idiot. I mean, they really are not equipped to be talking about any of this because they don't understand anything. And Fick was a really sharp guy. He's got fixed diffusion equation, cross-cell membranes. I mean, a very sharp guy. Medical physicist, MD, PhD, 1893. Now, if the medical field can't get it right from 1893, had 100 years, well, more than 100, do you expect anything out of their mouth to be right? Unfortunately, it's typically no. It's horrible. Fats can't go to fat. You have to have insulin to go to fat. Now, it's not intuitive. You go, if I eat fat, it's going to make me fat. No, it's burned for energy first. The saturated fat is burned for energy. The monounsaturated fat is also burned for energy. The essential fats, the parent omega-6 and 3, if there's any in there, goes to structure. There's no fat storage. There's no mechanism to take this fat and shove it into fat in us. It's only from carbohydrates. It's not intuitive. There's no way you could guess it. There's no way you'd know it. The same way there's no way you could guess how much sugar's in the bloodstream. I got to measure it and be told. It's like, why is the charge on an electron, whatever the heck it is? It doesn't come from anywhere, it just is. We don't know why nature decided to do that. It's the same thing with this. However we're made and created, it's the way it is. Very sophisticated machine, and unless you know all the parts of how we work, you don't want to go changing one thing, bless you. You don't want to go changing one thing because you don't know how it's going to affect the other. And it takes a lot of specialization. This is all I do. It's all I've done for years. And there's almost no one else doing what I do. I stay in one little area, the essential oils. I'm looking at this in diabetes and diabetic ulcers because there's no drug for that. These oils will cure that. They will heal ulcers that nothing helps. So it's a very exciting time for this. That's pretty much the background of where I started, and it's been a neat ride since then. I mean, I've got colleagues all over the world. Typically, they find my articles. I don't go to any doctors and say, hey, you need this, because that doesn't work. They typically find my work in a medical journal, in a book, and go, Brian, you've answered why what I've been doing doesn't work. And it's really exciting. And then patients all around the world, I know they all tell you we're all different. We're much more alike than we're different. If we were all different, you'd have 100 books on medical physiology because you have brown eyes and you have blood type O, and no, there's one. It's different books by different authors, but they're not different science. I want to be all alike. If we were all different, doctors would have a horrible time. They'd have a horrible time. Back to the water thing that, you know, how much water is in there? I have two cats. No carbohydrate, no grain, all meat. They drink no water. You put the bowl down, and I dump it every day and refill it the next day. It's never touched. They don't need the water from the food, and that's the proof. So if you're out in the sun doing work and you're thirsty, fine. But I never cease to be amazed. You know, I live by a big park, see all these people running around, and they're all lugging water bottles like you're going to be dehydrated. Dehydration is one of the most overly sensitive mechanisms we have. When you're thirsty as the dickens, you're only 10%. I assure you, none of you are going to get dehydrated and die. However, there's been numerous people killed by overdosing them on water. Horrible state of affairs. When we have the break, I hope you'll read, at least glance through one of the books. PEO Solution is 2015. It's very, very current. That's state-of-the-art science on these oils and disease prevention. 24-hour diet has the same kind of material. It's what is a carbohydrate, fat, protein, how this stuff works, what do you do for exercise, why the protein powder fruit smoothie is such a savior for diabetic patients, fulfills your cravings. It's in both books, but they're different focuses. So if you're interested in how do I lose weight safely and keep it off where it's going to stay off and not a ping pong ball, that's the one. But please make this material your own. Told you before, I don't want you believing what I say or accepting anything. That's faith. That's not me. I'm a scientist. So make it your own. It's worth 4 hours. Dr. Matheson can come up in a few minutes. He is from, he lives now in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Came specifically for this, to talk to you about some great results he's just had with the parent essential oils. Undergraduate degree in biochemistry. So he knows the science. And actually heard me on a radio show that I was told the radio show wasn't very good by the show's host. The reason he's here and found me and helped save patients' limbs from being amputated is because he heard that show. The doctors aren't used to science. All I would say is, I don't care everybody's saying how great fish oil is. Scientifically, it's a poison. And they don't like that. And I'd even give them the reason why. They don't like it. So Dr. Matheson was an emergency physician 15 years. So he's used to very intense stuff. There's no time to figure out what's going on right there. You better be right and think, or your patient's dead. Was the biggest provider in Ontario, Canada for pain management. And his chronic pain management medical clinics became the biggest provider of chronic pain management in Ontario. And his protocols became the standard of care in pain management for the entire province, which is the biggest in Canada. So that's pretty darn impressive. That kind of thing gets my attention real fast. Dr. Matheson's used the oils for 3.5 years or so, and I want to bring him up so he can talk to you about specific clinical results. I'm a theoretist, so I'll do experiments to prove what I say works, but I don't have patients. I'm not an MD. I'm a theorist. I'm a basic theoretical physiology guy specializing in membranes and very limited, but he sees patients, but he knows the science, so it's great. Dr. Matheson here? There he is. Thanks. So he'll be talking to you about some of his experiences. Then we can have a break for maybe 15 minutes and really go through those books out there. Just thumb through them, you'll see the quality. And then there'll be more questions and answers because that's great. You can ask Dr. Matheson anything you want.
Thanks. Well, thanks for the invite. Thanks, Brian.
Thanks for coming.
Yeah, it's been enjoyable. It's my first time in Des Moines. So it's not as flat as I imagined. There are some hills here. Anyways, as Brian said, when I started down this pathway, I did a four-year degree in biochemistry, did my fourth year in lipid biochemistry. Then, of course, you go to medical school, and what happens in medical school, you spend the first 2 years learning about the human body, and then the next 2 years it says, oh, this drug treats this thing, and this drug treats this thing, and this drug treats this thing. I was always a bit of a rebel, I guess. I always sort of question things. There's specific instances in my medical school training when I would bring up contrary ideas, it was just sort of dismissed as that's just not the way it's done. And that's when I started sort of questioning things. Now, I went into emergency medicine, as I said, practiced for 15 years of full-time emergency room work. And what was happening, of course, when you work in the emergency room, you're not, it's not the most sociable profession, because you're working evenings, nights, weekends, right? And what happened was my kids got to school age, and I really wasn't seeing them, because every time they would come home from school, I was going to work, or I was still in bed sleeping from the overnight shift or whatever. So a friend of mine was in pain management, and he says, you know, it's daytime work, pays pretty well, and you don't need a lot of experience to do it. I said, well, that sounds like a good deal. So I started practicing pain management, sort of learned some techniques, and I looked and I went to the first meeting of the OMA section, the Ontario Medical Association section on chronic pain. I looked around the room and I said, oh my God, there's such a collection of weird looking guys here. I realized there was no standardization the way pain management was done. So I decided to gather a group of people that I knew were interested in the program, and we self-taught ourselves pain management. We opened up the first clinic in 2003. And that clinic eventually became the standard that Brian was talking about, that the college uses to judge all clinics in Ontario. So fast forward a few years, I'm into a very successful pain management program, but it's still very traditionally based, right? A lot of medications, a lot of opioid prescribing, things like that. And it got to a level uncomfortable because I kept hitting a wall, right? So every time, you know, patients would come in and say, yeah, doc, but I still have the pain. Can't you do more? And it was very frustrating as a physician because you're on maximum doses of everything. There's nowhere to go. And I really didn't have anything to offer. So about four and a half years ago, you know, I was doing my practice, and one of my colleagues, she started, sort of forced me on a nutritional program. And doctors didn't believe in nutrition, right? We just poo-pooed it, right? Like everybody, all the doctors do. And she's fairly strong-willed. So basically forced me on it. And I didn't do it completely, but I did it enough to realize that within 2 weeks, my inflammatory issues settled down. I decided to do the program more fully. I lost 20 pounds and 6 inches of my waist. And, you know, back pain went away, or wrist pain went away. Stuff that I just thought was part of turning 50 was it. And it, of course, it's not. And so I started doing some nutritional stuff with my patients. And on that particular program, I had four patients lose 100 pounds in 8 months and come off 80% of their medications. And that's something that does doctors, it's very satisfying for me, but I don't know how many times you go to doctors, how many times they take you off a medication, right? It's always just, the system is, now I don't know how the system in the States, I'm sure it's similar to Canada, we have socialized medicine there, but the doctors get paid per visit, right? So what happens is the doctor already has his pen on the prescription pad when you walk through the door, right? Because he says, I don't have time to see you and discuss your problems. Here you go, get out. I assume that a lot of that happens here as well. And so to counsel patients and stuff, to fix nutrition, was very time consuming. But what tweaked me was that by just correcting a few nutritional problems, I was able to make a big difference in people's lives. So I decided to do a fellowship in anti-aging medicine. And that's when I ran into Brian's talk. And in my undergraduate experiences in lipid biochemistry, when I heard what he was saying, I said, you know, that guy's right, right? His science is right. It's not disputable. This is stuff, and he wasn't talking about stuff that's latest cutting edge technology stuff. This is just basic stuff that's been known for 100 years that I got taught in undergraduate, and I don't know why it sort of disappeared. So I was able to get a hold of the supplement after a bit of a search. It wasn't that well known at the time, and I started using it myself, and I said, yeah, you do feel better, right? So then what happened was my son's hockey coach came to see me, and he's 60 years old, and he had a bit of back issues. And so I said, John, here, I just got this in. Tell me what you try it. Tell me what you think of it. So he calls me a month later, and he goes, what in the hell is in this stuff? And he says, I've been taking supplements all my life. He still plays competitive hockey. And he says, I am now out skating all the 30-year-olds on my team. And he had no lactic acid buildup, no recovery time. He had great energy right to the end of the game. He says, he's never experienced that before. And he took everything. So I explained to him that it's an omega-based product, it's plant-based, and I said, you can order your own bottles and stuff, and he went one step further. He says, no, I want to meet Brian. He said, I want to meet the developer. So we, lo and behold, John is a persistent guy, and we met Brian face-to-face. We met the maker of the PEOs, and we decided to start up a business together, and that's sort of how Brian and I have kept in contact throughout the years when he started. And I started using it more and more in my practice. And I had some really big turnarounds in areas I wasn't expecting, right? So I knew that it would make people perform better. I got a lot of friends on it. That, you know, I would, you know, because as a physician, you know, you go to your son's hockey game, everybody starts talking about their health problems, right? They go, oh, my knees are sore, this is sore, or whatever. And so I started telling my friends, you got to try this stuff. So one of my first friends had tried it. He was a avid golfer, but his knees were killing him. He could barely walk up the hill to the greens, and anytime he had to go downhill, it almost killed him. I said, just try it, see what you think. 2 weeks later, his knee pain's gone. So another friend is also in his 50s. He got into CrossFit, right? CrossFit is that intense, athletic training. He wanted to do competitions, but his knees, again, were killing him. So I said, you've got to try this. And so he went on it. And 2 weeks later, he calls me, says, my knee pain's gone, and my trainer says that my cardiovascular output or performance has gone up by 30%, and I'm now outlifting all the 20-year-olds in the gym. And I'm saying, there's some real effects here. So I kept getting these stories back from other friends who've tried it. One of my friends is a ultra marathoner, right? So he had both knees scoped twice. He was, again, complaining about knee pain. I said, go on this stuff, see what you think. In that summer, he ran 4 100-kilometer marathons plus the Canadian Death Race, which is a 125-kilometer race up and down the mountains outside of Calgary. All right? And he had no injuries for the first time in his life during that season. It's the most he's ever run. Right? I have another friend who is a female bodybuilder, and now she started using more and more because she liked the effects so much. So she was using up to 12 to 16 a day. And she, one of the big things that bodybuilders, if everyone's ever done it, is when you do a leg workout, you can't walk for almost 3 days afterwards. When she started using those amounts, there was no issue. She was fine the next day. She actually tweaked her knee, and it was before a competition, and she thought, I won't be able to compete because her knee was swollen, it was awful. She thought she was done. So she went as high as 20 of them a day for 3 days, and the swelling came down and she was fine. And so I hear these stories over and over again. So as far as medical stories go, that's when things really started getting interesting. Because in the chronic pain practice, I got people whose pain levels would come down, I would get rid of headaches, but it was the other effects that I wasn't expecting. So I had a woman come in, she saw me for back pain, and but she was a vasculopath, right? So she already had a bypass surgery when she was 50, right? And she came in crying one day, and she says, well, I said, what's wrong? She says, they want to amputate my right leg below the knee. She had developed such narrowing in the arteries that it was compromised the blood flow to her leg. And I said, before you do this, please just try this. I think I actually gave her 2 bottles, and I said, just take them. She came back a month later, her angina, which is the heart pain, had gone, and the leg was fine, and they canceled the surgery. All right? And I said, that's impressive, right? Because that saves the system tens of thousands of dollars, and of course saves her an unnecessary surgery. I had another instance where, and this wasn't in a patient, but I was appearing on a small TV show in Toronto, and One of the guys on the show had written a series of cookbooks, but he also happened to be a type 1 diabetic. All right, so he's insulin dependent. Now, he ended up getting pancreas and kidney transplant. So his type 1 diabetes got better, but he still had all the complications of it. And on the show, he was wearing a cast boot, you know, the plastic cast boots on his foot. And, of course, they ask him, did you sprain your ankle or something? He says, no, actually, I have an ulcer on my foot that's not healing, and they want to amputate my foot. And so after the show, I went up to him and I said, you know, you have to try these. Please try them. He thought about it for a few days, and he finally called me back and says, yes. So sent him a couple bottles. He was using a minimum of 4 capsules a day. But 5 weeks later, he texts me back, and he says, you know what? My foot's getting better. The pain is lessening, and they've canceled the surgery. All right, There is no drug, no indication for that. And so I kept getting these stories and more powerful. Now I've designed a sort of a migraine protocol, which I'm really excited about. Which the key element is the oils. I had a woman even just at Christmas time here. She'd been off work for a year because of a continuous headache that hadn't gone away.
Wow.
Right. So she's well on the way to developing fibromyalgia, which some of you might know what that is. But she was totally debilitated. Now, one of the problems you run into with people who are acutely inflamed and in pain is their brains don't work very well, right? So you tell them to take something, and they may not, because they don't understand what you're saying, or they just forget, or whatever. But this woman actually brought her mother with her, who was in her 70s, old Italian mother. Well, not old. 70's not old. So the mother says, Dr. Matheson, whatever you say, I will make sure she does it. So I gave her my protocol using 8 capsules a day, and 3 weeks later, the headache's gone. I said, that's how fast these things can work. And she'd been off work for a year, right? So you can turn people's lives around. Now, it's not only for our own health. I mean, one of the problems that we haven't even seen yet is in our children. The statistics on children are getting outrageous, okay? So 2011, in the Journal of Pediatrics, they published an article looking at chronic disease in children. When you look at the top 22 chronic diseases, 54% of children in the United States have at least one of those right now, right? Which is astounding. Autism. Autism, when I was a kid, was 1 in 10,000, right? Now it's 1 in 50. I mean, if you have kids or grandkids, they probably go to school with 2 or 3 or 4 autistic kids, right? That was unheard of in my day. I knew one autistic kid when I was a kid. At the current rates, in 10 years, it's going to be 1 in 2. And it's completely environmental. It's what we're doing to ourselves, and we're doing it to our kids. So we have to correct this problem, right? We absolutely have to do it. It's not fair to have our kids start off with such poor health. This is going to be the first generation that our kids won't live as long as we do if we don't do something now. And the oils are part of the solution, because as Brian says, look at any product on any shelf and tell me what's in it. Canola oil, by far number one, right? It's in everything. And they keep marketing it as a healthy oil. Yeah, it's crazy, right? The reason the Oreo cookies don't rot on the shelf is because the bacteria can't eat it, right? The bacteria can't eat it, why should you? So, I mean, we're gonna have a question and answer session after that. I just wanna give you a bit of my experience, my background, and how I got to this point. I'm not gonna belabor, Brian's gone over a ton of science, right? And I know he's pretty rapid fire, and I know some people are trying to write notes and stuff. The problem is that it's really important information, but you almost have to learn it yourself, right? And I tell my patients, part of my protocol is I make my patients actually read to educate themselves, because you're going to have to be your own advocate, right? Because physicians will not tell you this information because they don't actually know it themselves. And I had to relearn it all. I mean, I 20 years after my biochemistry degree, here I am going back going, oh my God, did I really forget all that stuff? And once you relearn it, the world makes so much more sense. The human condition is to be healthy. It does not want to be sick. We make it sick, all right? We put stuff in there that makes it sick. You put in the right stuff, your genetics will do fine. They want to be good. An article I just read last week, an opinion piece written by a top cancer specialist. And the cancer specialist says, cancer is 1,000 different diseases. And it's like, no, it's one, right? It's one disease expressed in maybe 1,000 different ways. But the fundamental problem in cancer is all about oxygen delivery to the mitochondria for energy function. When your mitochondria of your cells can't produce energy, the nucleus of the cell doesn't function, you get a cell on autopilot, which means it starts dividing and it doesn't stop. And that's what cancer is, right?
And no intelligence.
Yeah, it's no intelligence. No, another article, I was just telling Brian, again, it was only 2 weeks ago, they were able to remove the mitochondria from a human cell, and guess what happened? It just started dividing, and it never got old, and it never died.
Wonderful.
Yeah, that's immortal. You've just created cancer,
and
right?
Yeast.
So it is a really important message to get out there, and it's really important to realize that the human condition is to be healthy. Don't let yourself be unhealthy. Before we, I did have one. There was one specific question about non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Someone wanted me to talk about that. So in the 1980s, fatty livers were only seen in alcoholics, right? Whenever we got someone in the emerge, you do an ultrasound of the abdomen, they have a fatty liver. The first question you'd ask, do you drink a lot of alcohol, right? Well, 30% of people in the United States now have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. It was unheard of in the 80s. Now, what happened, of course, if you remember back in those days, there was a sugar embargo. Remember the sugar embargo when sugar price of sugar went through the roof? Yeah. So Coca-Cola and Pepsi had to come up with an alternative. And corn syrup is cheap. It's the most heavily subsidized crop we have. And so they started using high fructose corn syrup. The problem with high fructose corn syrup is that the fructose in the corn syrup is not bound to anything. It's free. In its free form, it's quite toxic. And the only organ that can get digested is the liver. When you start shoving all that fructose into the liver has nowhere to put the energy, so it starts accumulating fat, right? And eventually it starts impairing the liver's ability to function. And so this has led to an explosion of fatty liver disease that we did not see 30 years ago. So that was just one question that someone wanted answered. No. So when I see articles that ask, a lot of physician articles, when they say we don't know the cause of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, it's like, we do know the cause. It's been known in the biochemistry for eons. They just have forgotten, or they're not looking. So what are we going to do? Want to do a break first?
Maybe 10 more minutes of questions. If you have anything with fat, protein, carbohydrates, you can see it if you want, and we'll make you stand. Yeah. I mean, you could ask either thing, but we'll do 10 minutes of a couple of questions.
It will go. You have to get rid of the high fructose corn syrup and get back to a low carbohydrate diet. Lots of proteins, lots of fat, and that's it. As I said, the body wants to be healthy. Just allow it to be. Yeah.
You mentioned fibromyalgia.
Yep.
Your friend, what's your protocol for fibromyalgia?
So fibromyalgia is interesting because fibromyalgia is not a pain problem. It's a pain sensitivity problem. Okay, so if you know anybody who has fibromyalgia, you know, you give them a hug and it hurts and all this stuff, they walk upstairs and their knees and hips hurt, but they don't have any inflammatory issues. It's because what actually happens is their endorphin levels. So everybody know what endorphins are? Endorphins are your natural painkillers. We're supposed to have a normal amount of endorphins at all times. If you actually study fibromyalgia patients, you realize their endorphin level is like 35% lower than normal. So now they're unmasking all these pain centers. So you really just have to make them healthy. You have to stop what's making them sick in the first place. And often that's the high carbohydrate diet. A lot of these people actually have undiagnosed gluten sensitivity problems, you know, wheat problems. They also have a lot of bowel problems usually, right? A lot of bloating, gas, diarrhea, constipation, that sort of stuff. Symptoms of what's so-called leaky gut. So the protocol, you have to recondition their gut, So you have to stop the gluten. I have them stop dairy often. I supplement with the oils. I also put them on high dose vitamin D. I also bump up their B vitamins because they don't absorb enough B vitamins. So you often find in fibromyalgia patients their B12 levels are really low because they're not absorbing properly. A lot of these people get put on antacid pills. Antacid pills, does anyone tell you that? I'm sure some of you people are on it, right? Are you on Nexium and things like that? Yeah, did the GI guy who did that tell you that you need a vitamin B12 shot every week because you're on it? Because you can't absorb vitamin B12. Yeah, so eventually what happens when vitamin B12 level drops to a low enough level, you actually start getting chronic pain problems. You get neuropathies, you get... Yeah, so, and now they're just, PPIs have been associated with higher risk, twice the risk of bone fractures. The latest one, PPIs, were now associated with chronic kidney failure. Yeah, so we always got thought that they were benign, but they're not so benign. Yeah.
We have a friend that just was released from the hospital that had a hip replacement, actually two, but one has just gotten infected. Oh. And he was told that that there's two options. One is to remove the hip that they put in, and he'll not be able to move for 2 years.
Oh, yeah.
And the other is hopefully using some new form of medication that's going to grab the infection and get it and then do something. But the oils and stuff, it sounds like this could work for him. And how much, I mean, I'll buy what he needs, but I don't know how much to give him.
Brian can answer that, but usually based on weight, right? But you can't really overdose on the oils because the body deals with the oils in a very natural way. If it doesn't need them, it just turns them into energy. But so a guy, sounds like a guy like that would probably need him at 12 to 16 a day to really get on top of things. That's a very dangerous area. So is the infection in his artificial hip? That's a problem. But it doesn't say you can't try it. Because it'll just make them healthier anyways. But having that artificial surface means that any antibiotics and stuff can't get at it, right? Because it has no blood flow. It's an artificial thing. But yeah.
Whew. Try the oils and the herbal for a week. In a week, you're going to know.
Yeah.
Because my father had sepsis and turned him around 3 days. So I would take 3 to 4 times normal amount, 12 oil capsules, if you do capsules, or a tablespoon is the same thing as 12 capsules if you do liquid, and a cup of the liquid herbal a day. That is just a phenomenal blood purifier, remember? An infection.
The beauty of this.
Try that.
The beauty of this. The beauty of this system is because it works so fast. So he'll know in a week, right?
Tops.
Right.
Tops.
That's the beauty. Because I mean, most of you have tried supplements and basically you take them for a month and you start, well, maybe I feel something. Maybe. That doesn't happen with this. You know it. That's good because your body's craving it. Your body's telling you, I need this stuff, and so it's going to respond. Yeah. Actually. Yeah.
Oh, sticking to the artery? Yeah, the oils make it where it's an omega-6 series derivative called prostacyclin, which is PGI-2, the term, but it makes it where the platelets cannot stick to the artery wall. Your artery's like a straw. So you have a cell going through it, and by the way, the cell has to deform. It's very interesting how cells go through capillaries ultimately. The regular big channels are okay, but the small capillaries, like in the brain, they have to deform and fit in the darn thing. So if you have a defective tunnel, it makes it very difficult. So it makes it very slippery on the outside, and the charge is such, it can't stick to it, and it can't stick to itself. Well, if it can't stick to the artery wall, there's nothing to start building up, and that's typically the number one reason for
strokes and heart attacks.
Heart attack is an occlusion.
You don't
get anything to do. All you do is take these oils.
Okay, so
it's that simple. Yes, what's your question? Oh, the number is high.
Yeah. So you got polyphagocytosis. Yeah. Again, you can't go wrong with just going with trying with good nutrition.
Have you tried these oils at all?
Right?
Have you tried these oils?
Yeah. She has a problem with high platelet counts, which makes her much more prone to blood clots and stuff. So,
are there any symptoms outside of the? Have you had blood clots?
No, it was discovered incidentally on a blood test, probably.
Oh, just recently.
Okay. Yeah. So.
No, that's huge.
That's right, because they put you on cytotoxic medications. And what they're trying to do is suppress your bone marrow,
damn,
which is probably not something you want to be on for a very long time, because it actually has a very valuable function. So the nice thing is, because it was caught at a stage before it was actually causing you any issues, going on the natural route for a month or two and getting another blood test
that's
and
what
seeing
I
what
too.
Happens is not a that's not a like a
two
dangerous
months.
Experiment. Don't. You know, so what? You were off the medication for 2 months. You were not on the medication for 30 years or 40, you know, right? Before that, so.
Yeah, this has happened just within the last 2 years. So I've been dealing with it for a couple years. Last year, you didn't order the weather very well on the night that you
came
here.
Yeah, I remember.
And I had to drive an hour and a half. And so I talked to you when you were on Michelson. But is there are you talking four times normal dosage?
Oh, dosage?
This stuff
I would do double. I would go four times because it doesn't work that way. I would do double. You know, it's typically one per every 40 pounds body weight. I would just double it. There's no downside to that whatsoever in 60, 90 days. I'd give it 60, seeing it's such a big effect, yeah. And then get a remeasure and just see. But even if it still stays that, there's probably not going to be much of an issue because they're not going to stick to each other and they're not going to...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're not going to cause a clot.
They're not going to cause a clot. So I mean, they're there. I don't know what that does by itself.
Mm-hmm. I would bet that it probably reverts.
It'll be very interesting. Just let us know.
Yeah.
Same thing with your.
Yeah.
Yeah. Please let us know.
Yeah, we're still finding out all the effects that it has, right? Because
it's the first time I've heard this one.
Yeah. So you just never know. But providing good nutrition, good cellular function, you can't go wrong.
They don't have a lot of research.
No.
Hi, I've paid attention to you, Mr. Peskin, since probably 1998 with Radiant Health. And
Yeah, it's way back in the beginning. Yeah.
I had talked to you one time because after using that, this I don't want to scare anybody because I think it was detoxing me. At the same time I was taking that, I started losing weight. I had a lung illness that I was coughing, you know, and I... found out that like last summer I even detoxed again and the same kind of symptoms
maybe taking too much at a time
happened again.
You probably want to cut it way back. That can happen.
Okay.
Too much garbage comes out and so you just cut, especially the herbal, the optimizer part.
Yes, and I think that's what was happening.
Cut it way back.
It was cleansing me, I think is what was happening.
Well, you want it out, but if it's too much is in there, too much comes out.
Yes.
For whatever reason. It's rare this happens, but I have heard of it.
So
I'm
wondering...
typically we say cut it back in half.
Okay.
So typical, the liquid herbal is an ounce a day. Do a half an ounce
okay.
or a third of an ounce.
So have you heard of adding pectin to anything
that
doesn't seem to work or help?
No.
Okay.
No.
It's the part of the fruit, you know.
I know what
inside.
It is.
Yeah.
jellies and stuff with it, but I have no idea why it would do anything.
I had somebody want me to ask that question.
So. No.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
They've had me on Prilosec for acid reflux.
Mm-hmm.
And
too many carbs. That's typically the answer, by the way.
Yeah.
And basically the carbs are causing. I've been on your oils for years, but...
Because if you eat cheese or a steak, no potato, no bread, I will bet you $100 there's no reflux.
So I've had joint pain, and that comes from, probably the vitamin B12, did you say? Or?
Yeah. The B12 deficiency is grossly underdiagnosed in our society. In fact... What if you actually look at the range of normals over the past 30, 40 years, normal is actually getting lower, right? Because the majority of the population is getting sick. So I don't know what it is in the U.S. I know the Canadian numbers, but in Canada, the B12 level of 115 or above is considered normal. In Japan, it's 550.
Woo.
Right. So the Japanese, and the Japanese live longer and have better health than we do. So I would actually use their normal, right? Even vitamin D levels. I don't know if you guys, everybody should get their vitamin D level checked. It's amazing. I've done 250 vitamin D levels in my patients. Only had three people in the normal range. The normal is anywhere from 70 to 100 in American units. In Canadian units, it's 150. It's 150 to 200. I would bet that a lot of people in this room, you did your vitamin D level, you'd probably be in the tens or twenties, right? Especially this time of year, right? So we're way short of vitamin D. One of the problems we have is we're not outdoors at all anymore, right? We're always indoors working. We used to get it from the eggs and from our animals and stuff, but they're raised indoors now too, so they're not getting their vitamin D. So how can we're not getting it from our food and we're not producing ourselves? And vitamin D is not a vitamin, right? It's a hormone. That's what people don't realize. It's a hormone that tells us how much sunlight we're getting. And when I correct vitamin D levels, I get tremendous results as well. And that's, everybody should get theirs checked. Everybody. D3. Has to be D3 taken daily. Not once a week dosing, not once a month. It's a daily dose. You have to mimic what nature does, right? We're supposed to be in the sun all day, so our vitamin D is actually highest in the evening. Right? Makes sense. Also, if anyone's got darker skin, you definitely need some, because white skin can get an adequate dose of vitamin D in direct sunlight at noon in about 15 minutes to half an hour. And in dark skin, it can be anywhere from 2 to 4 hours for the same effect. All right, so that's one thing that is dependent. And you know how these doctors tell you don't go to suntanning beds? Do it 3 or 4 times a week. Makes you feel good. It actually works. Don't ignore that. All of that skin cancer, that's crap. It's terrible.
Take a quick break, or one last question, and then have a break.
I'd just like you to repeat something you said earlier mm-hmm. about the development of cancer, that it's actually oxygen deprivation to the mitochondria.
Yeah,
this actually, is all Otto Warburg's work.
Yeah. Would you repeat his name?
Yeah, Otto Warburg, W-A-R-B-U-R-G. Nobel Prize winner, MD, PhD, greatest physiologist of the 20th century.
Otto Warburg is interesting because he never published anything without doing the same experiment 100 times and getting the same result every time. You don't get that done today in science. There's a publish or perish thing. So Otto Warburg, did you get the name okay?
I've got it.
Yeah, it's all tied to lack of cellular oxygen, not in the bloodstream, because that's a pulse oximeter. You can measure how much oxygen in the bloodstream. Everybody's going to be high. It doesn't matter.
How much gets to where it's used?
It's cellular, and it takes years, and it can be intermittent. So my big thing was, how can you do this? Okay, he figured out how it was, and the way they proved it in America, actually, in 53 and 55, they deprived heart tissue of oxygen intermittently over a while. And every heart cell they did it with turned cancerous. Every heart cell they didn't do it to, no. And then they looked at low oxygen in mice, and they put in plant spores, and they germinated where there was no oxygen. The oils are cellular oxygenators. That's what I discovered in this whole thing. So that's the practical application of everything Warburg came up with. Nobody's come up with this, which is incredible to me. Campbell talked about it in one paper in cystic fibrosis, which is oxygen deficiency in these patients, the pediatric journal in 1974, but did nothing with it, or either 74 or 76. So it's been published, but he didn't really understand his own ramifications. So you put these oils in the cell, I don't know how you're going to get cancer, unless you walk through a radiation field or anything. It takes years to develop this garbage with it came on fast. It's absolutely wrong. It has nothing to do with genetic mutations. That is utter garbage. The BRCA gene, all this stuff. More people get cancer without these genetic things, which means that's not the cause of anything. They're giving you garbage. Weinberg is the professor that came up with the terminology oncogene. He's an MIT guy. That's where I went to school. He reversed it, saying we actually measured it, and there's 5 to 6 mutations for million base pairs of DNA. There has to be a hell of a lot more. There's not enough. So anybody saying it's a genetic mutation, that's all been reversed. Today, cancer is looked at as a wound that doesn't heal. Again, what do you heal? These oils. And the mitochondria screwed up. How does the mitochondria get screwed up? That's all your energy producers. And there's multiple mitochondria in every cell. So you have 100 trillion cells, you could have five times more mitochondria. They make the energy. That's where the Krebs cycle and all the energy production goes. The inner membrane of that is all parent omega-6, called cardiolipin. This has also been published, and nobody puts it together. I've never seen any article outside of my own saying why the deficiency occurs. They talk about it, and they get right up to the cell membrane, and that's where I live, and that's Dr. Matheson understood, too, in the last year of his biochemistry. But physicians today don't study this at all. Big Pharma doesn't even have a division because they're either in plastics or petrochemical. There is no lipids division in Big Pharma. They have no interest in what I do. All they care about is blocking or impeding a pathway. Cholesterol reductase inhibitor, beta blocker. Everything is blocker inhibit. They can't really do anything else because they don't have the tools. It's all synthesized drugs. They can shut it down, and they're killing you, by the way. So you do get the result maybe they're after, but then you get 10 results they don't want. But yeah, there's a book I did called The Hidden Story of Cancer, and it's out of print hard copy. It's in a couple foreign languages, but you can get a PDF of it or an ebook. So Hidden Story of Cancer. It is all of this, and it's very readable. You can look it up online. And you can buy it. It's phenomenal. It is. It's sold 10,000 copies in the States, mainly to physicians. Okay, why don't you take a quick break and look outside at the two books. Like I say, PEO Solution, More for Health, 24-Hour Diet, More for Dieting, and everybody here should be pretty healthy. You're not made to be a mess. I mean, you really aren't. See you soon.